Well, good morning, everyone. How are you? Welcome. On behalf of Pete and Nancy and the family in the Philippines, thanks very much for taking the time to honour Eva's memory. It means a lot to the family. It means a lot to us as sisters, all the Filipino family out here and church family, and I'm sure she's made friends with many and all. Before we get started, just some housekeeping things. If you're looking for the loos at some stage, as you came in, they were just there. So if you need to use the facilities, that's where they are. If you're thirsty at some stage, there's water at the bar there. You can have that. And obviously, we'd love for you to stay after the service to celebrate Eva. And so I think there's copious amounts of food, you know, so I don't think you'll go home hungry. I think there's plenty there. It's a wonderful thing, really. I'm reminded today of a... Also, when we come to the open floor, if you can use the mic, it's got a long cord so you can go wherever you need to go. But we are recording it for the sake of the family in the Philippines, and so it'd be handy for you to utilise this so they can hear whatever your speeches are and all that sort of thing. I know it adds an element of nervousness to speak into a mic, but you'll be okay, you know what I mean? It's for the sake of the family. So first of all, we'd like to offer our condolences to Pete. First and foremost, you've lost a loving wife and a partner in life. Also to Nancy and her family. On behalf of everyone here, we'd like to offer sincere condolences and on the passing of Eva. From our perspective, we're Christians, we believe that she's gone from this room to the upper room. And so we're thankful in one way that the suffering is over, that the hardship of this life is over, and when she crossed over from their wilderness experience here, she crossed the Jordan to the Golden Shore. Jesus was there to meet her on the other side. Thank God for that. It's a wonderful thing to come to a Christian funeral. I'm reminded of twin brothers, and they one of the brothers died, and they were notorious liars, cheats, thieves, reprobate guys. And when it came to the funeral of the brother, the other twin brother went and saw the priest and said, I want you to say these words, and these words I want to hear at the funeral. He is a saint. And so the priest was wondering what to do, you know what I mean? Everyone knew the character of this guy. And so what he did at the time of the funeral, he said, well, we're here to say farewell to twin number one. And we all know that he was a liar, a cheat, a thief. But compared to his other brother, he was a saint. Sometimes we've got to fudge what we've got to say at funerals in memory of the people, despite who they were. That's not the case today. We have a wonderful, dignified lady who deserves all the honour, respect that we can give her. And so there'll be no fudging today. We can speak honestly from the heart, and that's a beautiful thing. This, just before we start, there's a couple of people, and it's only from my perspective. I don't want you to feel jilted if you're not mentioned or anything on those lines, but there are a couple of people that I think have gone in this whole affair extraordinarily above and beyond whatever was asked, and that would be Steve and Linda, if you can stand. We want to honour you this morning. Where's Linda? Good on you, darling. You guys... I don't know, whenever I was there, you were there. I'm sure you've held her hand while she was crying and when she was laughing. And what a support that you were, what a support. Also, Nancy at the front here, Eva's sister. And I do want to offer sincere thanks. I remember one Sunday looking into Peter's eyes and he was empty. You know, the tank was gone. And I was thinking, how's he going to make it? This was quite a while ago now. He was empty. And we were just praying And we have a little prayer group, and we were just praying, God, do something. And Nancy, you're an answer to prayer. You've given up months and months of your life and with your family. And I know that they sent you with their blessing. But still, what a commitment to give months and months of nursing a dying lady. And that deserves great honor. Let's... Your reward will be great in the kingdom of heaven, Nancy. It really will. It really will. Well, let's commence. There's tissues around the place, so you might need one or two through the service. I don't know. Maybe you won't. But we're going to open with a word of prayer, and then we'll commence the service. I'd like to encourage you when we have the open floor later on, there's an opportunity for you to say something. Now is the time to say it. You don't want to leave this place and say, I should have. That time will be gone. So if there's something you want to say, have it prepared. Have it good to go. Don't talk for half an hour. 2 minutes is good. You know what I mean? We just keep going, just so it's on the tape, whatever you need to say. But keep it brief, but keep it from the heart. And I'm sure the family will appreciate it. I'm sure people will appreciate it. So let's commence with an opening word of prayer, and then we'll start the service. Father, we thank you. We commit this time unto you. And God, we say, let your spirit just calm this place. God, even right now, Lord, even right now, God, we just pray that your spirit begin to mantle each heart. Lord, we thank you for Eva. God, she's the best she's ever been. She's never felt so good. Never felt so good. But God, today we stand here on earth heartbroken. And God, we're just saying, Lord, when these words are spoken, God, we understand there's no communication between the dead and the living. But we are saying, Jesus, just relay to her the stories and the memories and the comments that we've done today, that she might know that she was well loved in this place. And God, we thank you for that in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Alrighty. Well, there's a song we're going to sing together. Together is the... Together. Did you hear that? Yeah, some of you are not good singers. That's fine. Just sing loud. It's all good. That's good. The first one's called The Power of Your Love. It was Eva's song that she taught to the family. And so it's special to them. And so... we're going to sing that one, okay? Hopefully you know it. If you don't know it, that's fine. You can mime. That's no dramas. Righto. Ready to sing? So you rise up like the eagle, and I will show you. Your spirit leads me on. The next song we're going to sing is a favourite of Eva's called As the Deer Pants for the Water. Share a scripture reading and a little bit of message and a song, It Is Well With My Soul.
Thanks again, Paul. God bless you, Pete, Nancy, and of course all family and friends of Eva. Take peace in the knowing that our dear sister is indeed with the Lord. May the peace of God, the peace that surpasses all understanding, be with you in the knowledge that she truly is in a better place. I share this, it is my privilege actually to share this song. It is a hymn. It was one of Eva's favourites. And Peter has asked me if I would share the background of this hymn. It is perhaps one of the greatest Christian hymns of all times, and it has quite a remarkable story behind it. A fellow by the name of Hario Sackler lived in the late 1800s. He was a wealthy Chicago lawyer with a legal practice, a beautiful wife, a lovely home, four daughters, and a son. He was a devout Christian, and he lived in the time of a man named D.L. Moody. Many of you would have heard that name. He, in that time, was perhaps one of the leading biblical preachers of his day. At the height of his financial success and the height of their life, tragedy struck his family, where the one and only son was tragically killed. It was a short time after this, the death of the son, that the Chicago fires of 1871, which to this day live in the memory, not in the memory, but in the history books, of one of the biggest fires that ever took hold of the city, The Staffords lost almost all of their investment wealth in their property. Stricken with grief from the loss of their son, Hario arranged a trip for his family to go to Europe from America. At the last moment, Hario himself was called back with business and ministry issues that he had to attend. But because of the fires and the interests that he had to stay. And so he sent his family before him, and he was to follow a week later on the next ship. A couple of days into the journey, Hario received a text, or a, back in those days, a telegram, a telegram that said the ship had crashed into another ship, that all was lost, and only I remain. The message came from his wife. Hario had now lost his four daughters as well. Imagine the grief that you'd be stricken with, your family. Hario had simply got on the next boat that he could to be with his grieving wife. When they were crossing, the captain of the ship came to Hario and said that it was approximately in this vicinity that the ship went down. It was during this journey that Hario penned this hymn, and as I said, it is perhaps one of the most beautiful hymns ever written. It was one of Eva's favourites. And I wonder if you might all stand with me this morning and sing this hymn. Those of you who know it, in memory of this, it is well with my soul.
Thank you. Sea billows roam. Whatever.
Praise the Lord. It is well with you. If I could just share a very brief word on Eva's behalf. Eva struck with cancer. Eva's faith was like her eyes. It was God to whom she looked. It wasn't to the cancer. It wasn't the present. It was things above, as the scripture encourages us to do, is to look up. Again, when Eva was told that this cancer, which would prove to be terminal, Eva's heart was for her family and for her friends and for her loved ones, and I will show you what I mean by that. As one of Eva's pastors, when Pete told me the news, and understanding how grave the situation was, it became heavy on my heart. What would I say to Eva next time I saw her? We want to be honest, we want to have hope, but we need to be honest and realistic. The next Sunday, Eva came to me and I asked her, "How are you?" And I'd like to try to give you her answer as word for word as I can possibly remember as to what she said. And this is what she said. "I am okay, Phil. I know God can heal me if he wants to, but I am ready. Whatever is his will, I am ready. I'm ready to go, Phil. I only ask, Phil, please pray that God will let me see my family and tell them about Jesus." Mm-hmm. I understood Eva was telling me, was saying to me, that God, if you can use me in my dying state to reach my family, the realization that she was going to heaven, death didn't concern her, but the realization that maybe she'd not see some of her family again. I ask a question. How many people, would you just quickly raise your hand, have attended Peter's place when either Paul or myself was preaching there? Would you mind holding up your hand just quickly? How many? So many faces that I've seen here that have come. And I'd ask you this question. Do you think Eva's prayer was answered? I'm convinced. I'm absolutely convinced that God heard the prayer. This beautiful saint's dying prayer was not for herself, but for her family. This assured me. This is what gave me the assurance that Eva really knew her God. Her heart was for others, not for herself. We speak in terms of Eva was. Eva was a loving wife. Pete tells me so many beautiful things of what a wonderful wife she was and the things that she showed Pete, things that he held wrong, but Eva's beautiful way had shown him. And Pete, I'd just like to comment here, what a loving husband you are, Nancy, and a loving sister. It was less than a month ago that I was at Pete's place, and I just watched Pete one afternoon prepare the TPN pack, which was what was keeping Eva alive. And Nancy and Pete, I'm convinced that you kept Eva alive way longer than perhaps she would by the love that you showed her. And I watched Pete prepare the package, and she rolled it all out, and he sterilized all the table, and all the time, Nancy right by his side, it was just beautiful to watch, Pete. Beautiful to watch. But Eva was a loving wife. Eva was a blessed sister. Eva was a dear friend. But we speak in the past tense, but only relative to us. Only relative to us. If you remember nothing else today, remember this. Eva is. Eva is alive forevermore. Eva is with the Lord. The Apostle Paul said directly, "And for the Christian, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord." The believer, he who holds dear to Christ, is present with the Lord. Eva is eternally conscious, eternally alive, eternally joyful. Eva is. And we celebrate Eva's life. We're sad for our loss, but we are unexplainably happy for Eva's gain. Eternity together is the hope of all believers. Everyone who calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. All who are born again. Eva is indeed born again. Eva is indeed with the Lord. And everyone who is born again will see Eva again, and we will be together. But there is a tragedy. There is a great tragedy. And there is great loss. And there is great mourning. Death is truly final. It's goodbye forevermore to everyone who does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Jesus said it directly. Jesus said, some Bibles will say, verily, verily, I say unto you. Other Bibles will say, truly, truly, I say unto you. What Jesus was saying is, listen very carefully. Don't miss this. Understand this. This is so important that you understand. Unless a man is born again, unless a person is born again, they shall not enter the kingdom of God. They shall not enter the kingdom of God. This is the realization. This is the burden that Eva carried. Death didn't move Eva. I'm sure she had her moments. She would have had fearful moments. What human being wouldn't have? But it wasn't that that burdened her heart as much as it was for the love of her brothers and sisters. Oh, Jesus, use me, was her prayer. Oh, Jesus, may I see them and tell them about Jesus. I hope I'm being faithful in explaining to you what I believe Eva was trying to say. Mm. The dying prayer of your auntie, your friend, whatever you do, may you hear the word of God and be saved. If you don't know what it means to be born again, if you don't understand what that means, then there is a very strong probability that you are not. I would encourage you, faithfully as I can, on behalf of Eva, to encourage you to read your Bible, to pray, to ask God to help you, to lead you, and cry out to Jesus, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Oh. And you too can live in the blessed hope of knowing that one day we will all be together again, forever, in paradise, in bliss, in unexplainable joy, for all eternity. I know that I will be there with my sister Eva. God bless. Thank you.
Amen. Well, like Phil was saying, consistent with Eva's wish, we're going to have a short gospel message, is what we're going to do. Because really, if Eva could say anything to anybody right now, she would be screaming, find Jesus. Find Jesus. Find out who Jesus is. If you don't know who Jesus is, that's fine. It's okay to not know. But you need to find out who he is. That's the purpose of this life, is to discover who Jesus is and to glorify him along the way. So we're going to have a quick Bible message. Now, I do a bit of preaching, so when I say quick, no, I will keep it quick. It's all good. So you don't have your Bibles, but I'm going to read a passage to us about a man who had it all. A man who had it all. In life, he looked like he had everything that he should have, all the wealth that you should have, all the kudos, all the status that anyone should have in life. And he had all of that. And so Jesus records it. It's in red letter text in Luke chapter 12, and we're going to be reading in verse 18. And it says this. Well, let's go a little bit earlier. The ground of a rich man yielded plentifully. Okay? And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I'll do this, I know what I'll do. I'll pull down my barns and I'll build greater barns, and there will I store up all my crops and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, fool. Can you imagine hearing those words? When you utter your last breath, you stand before the Almighty, and the first word you hear is, fool. I can tell you what Eva heard. Welcome, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into your rest. But this man heard the words, fool. It says, fool, This night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? So it is he who lays up treasure for himself, but is not rich towards God. Is not rich. Three major mistakes this man made. Three major mistakes. And as we talk about them, I want you to ask this question. Am I making these mistakes? Am I making these mistakes? The first mistake, of course, was that he thought he confused his body with his soul. The passage says that he said, I've laid up for myself goods for many years that I may enter into my rest. You know, he's saying to himself, because I'm prospering here on earth, because everything's going well, because the ground is yielding all this fruit to me, I'm blessed. I know my soul is prospering. I've got the latest car, I've got the latest tablets, I've got the latest, the very greatest of everything. No one can outdress me, no one can outdrive me, no one else can outlive me, no one else has got a house like me. I've got it made and my soul is prospering also. What he didn't see, and the text leads you to the conclusion that the soul of this man was desperately starving. I think, you know, in this life, there's a big business at the moment. I'm an accountant. Big business of gyms. Is that right? There seems to be a gym on every corner. Who's a member of a gym, just quietly? No, no one's admitting it to. Oh, we're all the other half. But it's big business. Everyone's gym junkies jumping from one to another. They're all out there pumping iron. They're all running on treadmills. They're all doing everything they can to get this body in shape. I say, just forget about it. Look in the mirror and say, hello, this is me. But anyway, you do the best you can. They're doing the best to get this body in tune. And then you have conversations with people, and they are all about, because the next thing when you start getting on the health wagon, of course, some of you might be on this, you get on the healthy food wagon. Is that right? We got to eat this, and we got to eat that, and we don't eat carbs any longer, and we stay away from the sugar. Sugar's poison. And they go and they can talk to you for hours and hours about, you know, the sort of health food, and you need this vitamin, or you're feeling down, you need some more iron, you open their cupboards, you go into their kitchen, you know, and you open the cupboard and you think, my goodness, is this a pharmacy? There's that many vitamins in there, you know. I never thought I'd take tablets. I get up in the morning, the first thing I do is pop a pill, have some vitamins, you know. You get a bit older, you think you've got to hedge your bets. Why not? Have a crack. I remember we were going down to my kids play basketball, so we're dropping off our youngest daughter and to basketball, 8:30 in the morning. And the Rocky Road Runners are there. I don't know if you know it, down in that park there on the south side. And they're all going. And you know, it's Saturday morning. I'm thinking to myself, the first thought that hit me was, get a life. Saturday morning, what are you doing, you know? Anyway, one thing I noticed about running, I used to be a road runner myself, they never smile. They're all grinding it out, getting that body in shape. Is that right? And they can talk to hours about the sort of shoes and the sort of foods you should be eating and how you can do different things while you're running and the paces. They've made all this preparation, but they haven't made any preparation for their soul. Their soul is starving. Their barns are full. Their crops are yielding. But they are starving their soul. So that's the first mistake this man has made. Jesus says this. Think of the relative value that's in. Jesus says this in the book of Matthew. It says this. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his soul? Doesn't matter how many toys. The man with the most toys wins is the cry for the world. I'm looking at that box over there and I'm thinking, is that really true? Is that true? Because who cares what you've got in this life? Is that right? What matters is the people that have been affected, the people have been touched, and evidently Eva did a great job at that. There's plenty of us here. Mistake number two. He confused himself for God. What's all this, my barns, my crops? What's all this all about? Do you think for a moment this guy
made the soil in which his seed would go, or did he even put the information in that seed, which when it goes into the ground, somehow miraculously, it turns into a plant and yields a crop? And do you think this man somehow made the sun shine on this crop so that it would grow and bring just enough rain so the crop grew beautifully? What's all this my barns, my crops, my, me? What's all this about? He'd confused himself for God. But how many times do we say, my superannuation fund, my bank account, my investment property, my inheritance? We confuse what's God's and what's ours. That's the mistake this man had made. Six times in the passage it goes on, I. And then another six times it's me, myself, me. And if there's anything about this generation, it's me, I. Has there ever been a generation where there hasn't been so many selfies, photos taken? Not of other people. What's the first thing we do when we go somewhere? It's all me. This man had confused all about that. You know, I was looking for a song. I've been so busy. But I wanted to do something for my wonderful wife. She is the strength of my life. And there was a song that Lionel Richie sung that I want to record and sing for her for Christmas. But in the midst of all of that, I saw this little bit on Lionel Richie about songwriting, you know. And I think he was honest. He's at the end of his career, you know what I mean? He's getting to the end, so I think he was honest in the way that he spoke about songwriting. What did he say? He said this. They said, how is it that you've written some of the greatest love songs in history? You go through his hits, they're enormous. You don't realise until you go through it. You know what he said? He said, I don't know. He said, you know what happens? He said, I was having the happiest day of my life. And I bounded into the studio thinking I'm going to write this beautiful, happy song. And he wrote, some of you remember the song? He wrote a tragic love song called Still. I Love You Still. Sad, sad song. He said, what happened? He said, I sat down and it just came to me. Then he said, I was so depressed. I was so down, I felt as low could be. And so I thought, I'll just go in and I'll write a really sad song. You know, this is the time to do it. Do you know what he wrote? All night long, all night. He said, where did it come from? He said, honestly, I don't know. I sit down and the song comes to me. And you will find many creative people that say that. Don't know, I just sit down and the painting comes to me and it just flows out. It's something of God that comes in and flows out. It's not yours to keep, it's flowing from God, that thing. It's not your barns, it's not your crops. The fact that you're yielding this talent is not you. But this man made the major mistake of confusing himself with God. Mistake number three is, and our final one, he mistook time for eternity. Can I ask you an honest question? I'll come and stand here, just so it's you and I. Who's thinking inside your head? Who talks to themselves here? Put your hand up if you talk to yourself. I tell you when I hear it, I'm standing over a gatto. And you may have noticed. And I'm saying to myself, don't eat it. And if you eat it, have a small slice. And then I find myself, when everyone's gone to bed, standing with a light in front of me. I realize it's the fridge. And I cut myself a huge piece and I eat that thing. I'm telling myself, don't do it. But I'm doing it. Do you know that we call that insanity? There's actually a condition called hyperthyroidism where you're mentally altered and you have this experience. It's insanity. It's really insanity to talk to yourself. The fact that you're talking to yourself tells you one thing. you're not thinking, your thinking's not driven by a bag of chemicals called your brain. If it was, you'd be sitting here a prisoner of your brain. You wouldn't know what's coming next. You don't know whether you're going to stand up, take all your clothes off and run naked down the hall. You couldn't know, could you? Because your brain could just have a chemical synapse, bang, and you'll be off. You could stand up here and start singing all night long, all night. You'd be a prisoner of yourself. That is proof that who you are, your soul, is not you. This is the computer. You are the software that drives this computer. The software is still around. The computer has had a Windows failure. One day it will get a reboot. One day it will get a reboot. Life is short. This man thought he had many years. He said, look, I've got lots of goods stored up for many years. Lots of years ahead of me. I've got plans, baby. I'm not just sitting here, you know, twaddling on the sea. I got plans and I got money and I'm going to make it happen. I'm going to change the world. This is this man's thinking. I got many years. I tell you what, I've made it so big, I can just sit back and relax. And God said these words to him, you fool. Tonight your soul is required of you. Tonight your soul is required of you. Can I tell you a quick story and we'll finish with this? Many years ago now, I've been a Christian for maybe 28 years. Gee, time does go, doesn't it? 28 years. And I got saved at 3. And my first church, Opal Hall. Anyone remember the old Opal Hall? Anyone been in Rocky for a long time? Anyway, there was down there where the police youth club is. And my first pastor was a Dutchman, you know. He was a church planter. He was only good for 6 months. Didn't know deep theological things, just the gospel. So he used to go and start churches, get them going, get out of there. Anyway, so one night, you know, a Dutchman like, I hope there's no Dutchman here, very direct, you know what I mean? No fluffing, it's just straight in. Anyway, so he's preaching a gospel message, as he often did. And this young man, young Aboriginal man, is sitting at the back. And in the middle of the message, something caught this young man and he was offended by the message. The fact that he had to repent. The fact that he had some problem that only Jesus could solve. That was an offense to him. He's thinking, I can take care of things myself. And that's our catch cry, isn't it? Independent. Self-sufficient. That's what we're teaching all our kids. We're not teaching them to be dependent on God. We're teaching them to be self-dependent. Self-sufficient. That's what we want. And some of us with older kids are looking for that day. But it's not here yet, is it? But, so this guy is sitting at the back. Something goes forth and he's offended. He gets up from the meeting and you know he got up because the chair flew. We had independent chairs like this, but you know, the plastic ones. And so as he stood, he obviously wanted to make a statement. He stood up, that chair flew backward into all the other chairs and he walked straight down the aisle, out the door, bang, gone. And we all thought, wow. What do you say? Wow. But you know, that guy said, he's a young man, about 23, 24. He had some alcoholic dependency problems. God was nailing him at that opportunity. That was his opportunity to hear the gospel. He got up at that meeting and ran out the back, made a scene, got out of that place. We found out 2 days later what had happened to him. He went out, he got into his car, he drove past that, he went over where the old bridge is, went over near the Darimba Hostel and got hit by another car, died instantly like that. Gone. He thought, I'm a young man. I've got my whole life ahead of me here. Do you know what? You think you've got control over the day that you die. You and I are both planning our retirements and our packages. Eva thought she'd be here for many more Christmases. God comes and says, tonight, your soul is required of you. Tonight. And that could be today for any one of us. Everyone sitting here, one day, you will hear those words, tonight your soul is required of you. Who's to know it's not tonight? If Eva was here this morning, what she would be saying to you is, find out who Jesus Christ is. No man comes to the Father, no man gets into heaven but through Jesus Christ. Eva knows it to be true. She's crossed over. But she'd be crying in heaven for a family. She'd be crying in heaven for you. We don't want anyone to perish. You say, how do I find Jesus Christ? I tell you what you do. Take some time. Get into a quiet space and say, Jesus, I'm open to hearing from you. Find me. Then get his word, and you'll find Jesus will meet you on the pages of the Bible. Now, start reading, not in Genesis. That's where I started. My goodness, heavy going. Start in Matthew, in the New, or in John, something like that. And just ask one question. Jesus, who are you? Don't listen to a televangelist. Don't even listen to anybody. Let the word begin to speak to you, and you'll find Jesus in those pages, just as Eva did. Just as Eva did. What will a man give in exchange of his soul? And yet every one of us is exchanging something for our soul here today. What are you giving in exchange for yours? Have you found Jesus? Have you found Jesus? If you want to talk more, let's do that after the service, eh? Let's do that after the service. Righto, Nancy, do you want to come out and we'll... speak, you get you speaking into the microphone here, Dale. After this, it'll be the scripture reading for the ladies, so if you can get prepared. I'm just waiting for you, Nance, to get the right height. Got it down. The peepers. Come and stand up here, Dale. Talk in the microphone. Is that the right height? Lower. Is that the right height for you now? Okay.
There's a short story about me and my sister. It's with a great sadness that I stand here today. As we know, my sister Nance went to the Lord a week ago. But being parted from here was devastating for me. My sister Nats was the best sister anyone could ask for. My sister Nats was a loving and caring sister to me. When we were kids, we were so close together. And when somebody would kiss me, she was always with me. We were teenagers and we went to parties, to dances, and to the movies together. We sleep together, telling stories till we are.
Yeah.
We had our own escapades, only the two of us knew. There were boys that were interested in Nance, and they approached me first when they could come to the house and court her. If a boy came to the house, I was always there with her. Maybe that was, she didn't get married to a Filipino. Because I was her security.
Yeah. Go for it, man.
That's how close we are. And if boys were interested in me, Nas also told me she thought he was nice or not.
Mm.
I always knew that I could ask, I could talk to Nas about my problems. She always had a shoulder to cry on And she gave me a great advice that lifted my spirit. She was the sister who helped me through thick and thin. When she grew up, Lass would work at PMA, the Civilian Military Academy. She was studying commerce in college in Tokyo. I was married first and I had my first child. While she was working, even though I was married, we always had fun. If we went out with the kids, she always came with us until she got married at the age of 24 and came to Australia to live. We still communicate, and she was still there for me to give support, especially to my kids. She loved all her nieces and nephews, and they loved their auntie too. When Nas came for holidays in the Philippines, we spent quality time together. Sitting up late at nights, and telling stories about our lives. We went also out and had coffees together in the shops. We really had fun when she came to the Philippines. When the time came that my mom was ill before she passed away, Nas came home to the Philippines and stayed about 2 months. Mom was 82 when she passed away. When our dad got sick a few years later, Nas came home. She came for 6 months when he had a stroke, and later he became very sick. She came home to the Philippines and nursed him, and she stayed for 1 year. Even though I had my family, as we live in different homes, I moved back to the family home where I stayed, and we took good care of him, my dad. It was hard for her to come back to Australia because she was worried about what will happen to our dad. And she came home when dad passed away, and dad was 86 years old. Nas returned to Australia, where she lived and worked, and then she met Peter, my brother-in-law. After they got married, they came for a holiday, and we got to meet Peter, and we really had fun during their holiday with us and the family. My husband passed away and still had children to support, but Nas was always there for me.
Yeah.
And when I had the operation in my eyes, Nas and Peter were the ones who helped me. I have really enjoyed the chance to come here for Nas while she has been sick. We were so very close together. Even to her last bed, I was here for her. I would like to thank the Filipino friends and also the church friends for their love and unending support for me, and for them taking care of me while I have been here. Especially, I want to thank all the people who helped to get me here in Australia when Nas got sick, and especially to Joe and Annabelle, who helped with the papers in the Philippines and who brought me back to Australia with them so that I didn't have to make the journey by myself. I also want to thank Steve and Linda for coming to stay with us on weekends while Nas has been sick. My heartfelt thanks go out to the church, and especially to Jess, Paul, Rita, Lisa, Glenda, Phil, and for the efforts they have done to in organizing this lovely celebration. Service for Nati. My family and I would also like to thank our brother-in-law, Peter, for his sacrifices, love and understanding to my sister Eva, especially when she can't sing. I couldn't say anything more than to say with all my heart, thank you very much. The Lord will bless you. The last 6 months I spent with Nat, our memories I cherish, is where I saw her vulnerably. It's when she poured out to me all the things I didn't know about her life here, happy and sad. I really, really miss my sister. When I think of her, I cry. I look forward to the time when we meet again, my precious sister Nat. She was always told me during the last months of her life, Nancy, don't be sad, cheer up. I'm honored to be her sister. Thanks everyone for coming to celebrate her life with us. Thank you so much.
Bless you, Nancy.
In behalf of Peter, they requested whoever wants to go home between February and March to the Philippines, just give Peter a ring or let him know so that Nancy can go back in the Philippines, but with somebody. Please do that. Thank you.
Good on you, Dom. That's very good. Okay, Pete's requested that the ladies of our church read some scriptures that he wanted read for the service today. We've called it a memorial service. It's a funeral service, of course it is. But we're remembering who she was. And that was beautiful, Nancy. Thank you. Thank you, ladies.
I'm reading from 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 to 18.
Hang on, Reid. So we can hear it on the tape.
But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if you believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we, who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who are asleep. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words.
Anya.
I'm reading from Revelation 1, verses 12 to 18. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet, and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death."
The scripture reading is 1 Corinthians 15, 42-58. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown in a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. So it is written, "The first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, and afterward the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. As is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we also shall bear the image of the heavenly man. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, "Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ."
Hallelujah.
"Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labour is not in vain in the Lord."
Revelation 7, 9-17. "After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb.' All the angels stood around the throne, and the elders of the four living creatures, and fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb.' All the angels stood around the throne, and the elders and the four living creatures, and fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, 'Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.' Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, 'Who are these arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from?' And I said to him, 'Sir, you know.' So he said to me, 'These are the ones who come out of great tribulation, and wash their robes, and make them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will dwell among them. They shall never hunger any more, nor thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any heat.
Hallelujah.
The Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them, and lead them to the living fountains of water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes."
Hallelujah. There's no TPN in heaven. You'll never find an IV. You'll never hear the sound of an ambulance. You'll never need to have built a hospital. I tell you what, you want to make the most of your money down here if you're GP, because you'll be broke in heaven. You'll be broke in heaven. Now, just in a moment, we're going to have Peter come and share his eulogy. After that, I'm going to share a song. And after that, we're going to have an open floor. Those that want to say something, that's your time to say something. If we can, just as a point of organisation, when you come up, if you could come up, don't come up through the middle, don't come up by the side, we've got the camera over there, the projector's here. If you can come round and stand here in an orderly fashion so that you know who's next and just prepare for there. When we start it, the first message is going to be from the family. It's one that they've sent last night, and so that'll be the first message. So after I finish my song, feel free to come and wait here. The first message will be a video message, and then we'll just proceed from there. Is that everyone clear with that? All good? Okay, beauty. Thanks, Peter, as you come. Pull it down. That's it. To hear.
I was standing, you were there, two worlds collided, and they could never tear us apart. My apologies to NXS. I don't pretend to be a singer. But that chorus has some relevance to the story I want to tell. The story I want to tell is a love story. It involves my precious wife, Lord Jesus Christ, and me. The words aren't exactly right. It should go, I was praying, you were here. Two worlds collided, and they will never tear us apart. Boom, boom, boom. So, how did two worlds so disparate get to collide? I have to tell you a bit about both of our histories. I know this is really about Eva, but to make sense of it, I apologise, but I have to tell you a bit about me too. But first, I'll tell you about Eva. Because when we met, she lived in Rocky, and I didn't live anywhere near Rocky. Eva was born in a little place which I've never been to called Sagada, which is about 6 hours' drive over a really rough road in the mountains of the main island of the Philippines. And it's only like it's a remote little village, but apparently it's very beautiful. When she was 2 years old, most of her siblings are older than her, her parents decided that they'd go and move to Baguio City, which is it's still a beautiful city and it's still high up in the mountains, but it has all the facilities, and they did that as a sacrifice to their children so the children could get an education. The older ones were already boarding with people in Baguio getting an education, so Eva didn't really remember cigars at all, but the family always speak very fondly of it. And they told me that the house had lots of fruit trees and they could actually reach out the window of the bedroom and pick fruit from the trees. But Eva always spoke with great fondness about Baguio, and she didn't like the heat. Baguio wasn't like down the coastal lowlands, as she called it, and I think Ferdinand Marcos had his summer residence. It's a lovely big mansion in Baguio. So she grew up in obviously a very happy family. She loved her parents, always spoke extremely fondly of both parents. Mum was a very hard worker. When they moved to Baguio, her mum started gardening straight away, veggies and fruit and all sorts of things. Dad got a job. He'd been in the military, but he didn't like the military, but he had some good contacts in the military. That helped Eva. She went to high school. She started going to college. She was doing commerce, but one of the generals, I think, think, assisted and got her a job at PMA, the Philippines Military Academy in Baguio, which we went and visited when we were there in 2013. And she worked in, she did office work there, and I'm sure she was very happy doing that. She's one of 11 children. There was another one who I think was passed away very young, but luckily they all the others survived until last year, and they lost Pat. And it's a testimony to Eva, really, that for her care for other people, that when she got sick, she wouldn't let me tell the family. And you know, this went on for months. I said, "You've got to tell them." She said, "No, they're still grieving for Pat. It's not fair that they start worrying about me." That's the sort of person she was.
Yeah, that's what she was.
In telling this story, I do have to mention that we both had a previous spouse, and I don't want to say anything that's disparaging to them or judgmental, because if it wasn't for them, even I wouldn't have ended up where we were. But I did have to just tell things as they were, because it's the truth. As Nancy said, Eva went home for two relatively long periods to nurse both her dad and her mum. And I won't think of that yet. First of all, when she was 24, she got married to an Australian guy, a German-Australian guy who lived in Gladstone. And he brought her back to Gladstone. They lived there for about 6 months, and then they went to live on his property at Calliope. So I'm guessing it was a fairly isolated sort of existence for Eva initially, coming from the warmth and love of a close family to Calliope, outback Calliope. She didn't drive. And she didn't know anyone here, but to her great credit, half of this room is filled with people from the Basin region who, obviously love Eva and have a lot of time for it. So she made a lot of good friends, and she had friends from the German community, she had friends from the Filipino community, and she had lots of Australian friends as well. That marriage lasted 12 years, and they didn't have any children, for which Eva tells me she was actually grateful, because she doesn't know how she would have. She just couldn't picture herself being a single mum. When Eva came back from the last 12-month stint of looking after her dad, she was met at the airport by her husband then and some friends. She didn't expect friends to be there, but it soon turned out why they were there, that John, her husband, had invited them, because he was announcing to her that their marriage was over and she wasn't coming home with him. She was going to have friends. So that would have been a devastating shock to come all the way back and then be told marriage is over. But the Lord can use tragedy for good. Mm. And that's what set Eva off really looking to find the Lord. And she came under the wing of Presbyterian minister and his wife in Gladstone, and David and Margaret II. And she's been forever grateful for the Bible studies that Margaret took to, because as a result of those Bible studies, she got to experience a relationship with the Lord, which has stood her in good stead ever since. She learned to really trust the Lord, and she was streets ahead of me in that regard when I met her. She had a lot to teach me. So Eva lived in, she lived in Gladstone, and then she'd go home occasionally. She worked at, when she came back from one of her trips, she didn't have much. She had her clothes, she had a car. She'd get people to, Steve and Linda and others, to mind her stuff while she'd go home for a couple of months. And then she'd come back and then she'd get another job. She moved from Gladstone up to a property at Ambrose, which is between Gladstone and Rocky. And then Norma, one of her friends in Rocky, said, "Why don't you come and live in Rocky?" And she got a job at the laundry in Rocky, or a laundry in Rocky. And then she ended up working at Bethany Aged Care Centre, and that's what the career she sort of had, or vocation she had for the rest of her career, working in aged care. She moved to Rocky, she rented a room with Filipino friends. Most of you are probably here. Carmelita, the last friend she lived with, is here. Juliet, the previous one's here. I'm not sure if Minda's here. But she didn't possess much, but what she did possess was a wonderful relationship with her Lord. Mm. And she just trusted God for everything she needed. She loved her little red car. I don't know, is it on the photos?
Yes, it is.
She that car ended up with Minda, and we came up to Rocky after we were married to have a weekend at the coast, and we got here on Friday, and when we flew up, I organised to hire a car, and neither of my credit cards worked. I rang back work and I asked this bookkeeper, what's wrong? My credit cards aren't working. And she said, oh, I put the money on. I ring up card services and National Bank and, oh yes, the money's there. Why can't it work? Well, it takes 2 days to clear.
Oh, gee.
We're on an airport. Yeah. I've got to hire a car. I've got no way of getting around yet. Oh, I'm sorry, sir. That's the rules. Oh, I didn't know how I was going to tell you about that. She's sitting over there waiting for me to get the car. Went back and sat down. Said, oh, I don't know what we're going to do. What's wrong? Credit cards are not working. Tell them the stories. Well, we could ring Minda, see if we could borrow my car. So she rings Minda. 10 minutes later, Minda turns up, lends us the car for the weekend. She was unbelievable, believe it.
Beautiful people.
Didn't worry. She spent 18 years alone before we met. 18 years in mainly in Australia, just going home for a couple of stints. There were a couple of guys she told me she was interested in, but prescription-wise, she wanted a Christian man. And there was a guy that went to church in Gladstone, was a bit younger than her, and he was a good-looking young fella. She liked him, but she discovered he liked sport more than he liked God, so he got Okay, so meanwhile, what was going on in Eva's life? I was down at Victoria Point, which is just a little bit south of Brisbane, not as far as the Gold Coast. And I was building barns. I'd actually made an 80 year barns, so I didn't know you were going to preach on that today. Yeah. I was married for 23 years, and the best thing that happened to me was that I had three wonderful sons. Mm. And they were really precious to me. I actually had become a Christian when I was 27, or I thought I had. But my Christian life sort of waxed and waned. Intermingled with a lot of worldly life, you know, running a legal practice, running a family. I played hockey most of my career until I got a bit old and lottery. Yeah, just having a lot of mates and being a normal knockabout Aussie guy, I think I was. Other people might have a different idea. And there was a patch there where we'd gone through and actually started a practice from home at one stage, built that up, and you know, about 14, 15 staff working for me, kept changing the office space to the nicer space, bigger space. Had one house which was the family house. Then I found a great block of land by the beach, by the water, and we ended up building the home that I sort of had designed a couple of years earlier. And then I thought, oh, my investment thing, my security, yeah, my super, I don't have any super, so I started to invest in these investment properties, and they were very expensive investment properties. My plan was I was going to sell them off the plan 3 years down the track. And even though my dad, bless his soul, had always told me don't do that, I didn't tell him what to do. So we had this nice new house, beautiful mansion, by the water, three wonderful boys who were all playing sport and I was running around the sport. Wasn't spending much time on my spiritual life. Till I went on this fishing trip. Wasn't just an ordinary fishing trip. I must tell you this, I've never told anyone this story. I don't think I have. If I have, it's only one person. And this is the point where you say, oh, he's probably a crackpot. But anyway, I'm going to tell it today. I went on a fishing trip. It was over in WA. So two of us flew to Perth. We met up with the other guy who was a surveyor in Perth. We drove to 1,000 k's to Onslow from Perth. And then we got on a boat and we went to an island called Thevenard. And this is the Mackerel Islands, which is a real fishing ground, but it's a very remote place. And you stay in these little fishing shacks. So three of us in one shack. When you get to the island, they tell you the only way you can communicate with the outside world is you buy a phone card and you can use the phone box. So I did that. Been there about a week, and one night, and this is pitch black, it's an island, there's nothing there. Middle of the night, I'm woken up by this really, really bright light, which I realised once I'd sort of come to, it was in my head. And a voice said to me, Peter, Your marriage is over. I had my eyes and the bright light was still bright. And I started to sort of plead, because I figured this was an angel giving me an announcement. I didn't know who it was, but I just figured it was an angel. So I'm saying, Lord, no, you're the Lord of marriage. You're the Lord of marriage. My marriage can't be over. Please. And I must have lied there praying for another half an hour, and I couldn't get back to sleep. So I'm doing the maths about the time difference between West Australia and home. And I'm thinking, I've got to go and ring home, but I can't ring now, it's the middle of the night, and it seems absurd ringing in, just saying, is everything all right? So I figured out 7 o'clock's probably the right time to ring. So I walked through the sand dunes, still 5 o'clock down there, out of there, something like that. Put the phone card in, I ring home. Heidi answered the phone. Hadn't seen her for over a week. She goes, oh, hi. I said, oh, hi, is everything all right? Yeah, I'll put Rocky on. It's my youngest son. But I couldn't talk to him. Put Rocky on. I thought, this is really odd. Then I get paranoid about it. Wait and see what happens when I get home. So when I got home, I was just amazed by, I was an observer, and I watched my marriage go downhill with my wife's health. As I said, Josh, I don't want to say anything really bad about your mum, but she became an alcoholic almost overnight. She was already a type 1 diabetic. She shouldn't have been drinking. And with the alcoholism came all sorts of problems, and she became obsessed with one of my best friends. There was a whole lot of mess, but persevered because I thought I could fix her problem. I just had to fix the alcohol and everything else would be right. So I started going to Al-Anon meetings, I was going to counselling, I even went to AA meetings so she might feel okay about going to an AA meeting. Nothing happened. And I lost like 20 kilos in 2 months and the anxiety was killing me. And I was trying to do too many things well and I was doing nothing well, except praying. I started reading my Bible every day, night and day. Amongst doing all this other research, I wanted to know the truth and what I just wanted to fix my family. Heidi moved out. Counselor told me, Peter, you've got to get out of your head and into your heart. I had no idea what that meant. I thought, I'm a pretty heartfelt person, you know. I didn't know what it meant. One night, I'm walking the dog, which was a good time to pray. And it suddenly occurred to me, I thought, Lord, the first commandment, love the Lord your God with all your strength, with all your soul, with all your mind. I don't do that. I love my kids more than I love you. I love lots of people more than I love you. I don't know you well enough to say I love you, Lord. I'm sorry. I can't honestly say I love you. You know, I thought, that's the end of me. What's getting me? I'm thinking, is lightning going to strike me now? And how do we fix this, Lord? Obviously, the first commandment's there for a reason. It must be able to be obeyed. You know, there's no use obeying commandment number 6, commandment number 7, commandment number 10 if I can't get past first base. What do I do? So I said, Lord, you're going to have to show me how to love you. And I said that honestly. I didn't know what was going to happen. It took time, but the way the Lord showed me how to love him was he showed me how much he loved me. Fast forward a little bit, I got to a point where I could bear the thought of losing everything financially, because once, some of you may know, when things start going downhill, everything else goes down with it. So my financial strategy was a mess. We were heading for the GFC. The properties that I was going to sell off the plan hadn't sold because there was a hiccup with the way Mervac did things, and all of a sudden I had to settle on them. So I had to find like $1 million to buy a unit at the Gold Coast, and I had to find some more money to buy another unit. And I was never planning on buying these properties, so I had to service those debts. And I knew I couldn't in the long term unless I could sell the properties, and the properties' values were going down. So there were all sorts of problems. Problems at work. Anyway, for some reason in my heart I thought, I still got a lot of love to give, Lord. If you could find me a wife you know, maybe I can give her some love. You know, that was another heartfelt prayer. Enter Frank. Frank was a client who used to do a bit of conveyancing with us. He had lived in Gladstone, he and his wife. I hadn't met his wife. Frank comes along one day, and he's got a problem about a property in Sydney. And we don't deal in properties in Sydney, but anyway, we had a discussion and we worked out a strategy that we might, that I could go to the financier and help put this deal to the financier and it might extract this property for Frank. So about a week later, Frank comes back and he sits down and instead of asking me how the strategy is going, how did I get on with the financier, he starts telling me about his marriage. And he's telling me, Peter, Florence and I have been married about 25 years, it's been a wonderful marriage. And I didn't know Florence, so I didn't know she was from the Philippines until he sort of got onto how he met her in the Philippines and her family and whatever. I'm kind of thinking, where's this going? You know, I'm a solicitor.
Charge by the minute.
I'm wondering where this is going. So in the end, he says, Peter, Florence and I have got a friend. Her name's Eva. And we think you should meet Eva. Oh, I don't want to know about this, Frank, but I didn't say that. In fact, Eva might be coming down at Easter. From where? Oh, she lives in Northampton. Oh, felt safe all of a sudden. She's in Rocky Hill. Good. She can stay there. Anyway, Frank said, look, I'll give you her phone number. And he wrote it on a piece of paper. Very politely said, thank you, Frank, and put the note in my pocket, never intending to ever call this number. Frank's matter should have taken about a week to fix, but it didn't. Frank's matter took about 6 months, and Frank used to come in every week to see how things were going. And he'd say to me, Peter, have you rung Eva? No, Frank. I honestly had no intention of ever ringing Eva. It's not me, I don't ring up ladies that I don't know and haven't been properly introduced to. And I thought, well, if she comes down at Easter, you know, who knows, if they want to organise it, we could meet over coffee and that would be the proper way to do things. You know, I don't think this is right for me. Anyway, so eventually Easter came and went, she had to come down. Frank says to me, Peter, have you rung Eva? And I said, no, Frank, in fact, I've lost her number. Oh, don't worry about that, give us your phone. And he put a number in my phone. Still didn't intend to ring it. Now, I've got to tell you about gratitude. One of the ladies at Al-Anon, lovely old lady, she gave me some words of advice one day. She said, Peter, whenever you're feeling down, think about gratitude. She said, gratitude is the antidote to bitterness, resentment, self-pity, you know, all those negative emotions. She said, and I'm looking at her thinking, that doesn't make sense. No, love is. No, she could see the doubt in my eyes. She said, no, gratitude is. She said, look, if you don't believe me, next time you're feeling down, you just... She said, don't do it in your head. Get out a pad and a pen, and she said, start writing down a list of all the things to be grateful for. Mm. She said, might be hard for the first, she said, but as soon as you think of one, you will think of another. And she said, just keep writing. She said, I guarantee you, before you finish your list, you'll be feeling different. Your attitude will change. A couple of days later, I tried that and it worked. Now, like Paul says, inspiration comes to different people at different times, and painting, I know, is Paul's bent and Cam's bent, but it's not mine. I can't paint for nuts. Writing is my bent. I love writing. If I had a chosen career, I'd just be a writer. I'd write lots of different things. But I've tried writing lots of different things, but my problem is I don't finish anything. But anyway, one morning, Saturday morning, I had a busy life. I was trying to run a legal practice. I had three sons. One was an apprentice chef, one was an apprentice motor mechanic, and Josh was working in a light factory and he was doing sandblasting stuff. And his overalls were worse than the mechanic's or the chef's jacket. So I hadn't learnt to help them be self-sufficient. I was trying to mother them, and I was trying to do everything for them, make the meals, look after the house, look after legal practice. And I used to wash their clothes like every day or so. But I didn't mind that. The one thing in life I hated doing was pegging out washing. Because to me that was just a complete waste of time. I see you on the front balcony one morning riding and I had to go and hang out washing, and thought struck me. Lord, I know about gratitude. I know I'm supposed to be grateful for things, but I just can't be grateful for hanging out washing. Help me fix that. So he did. I found that after that, whenever I'd be hanging out washing, I'd get inspiration for writing. And then I'd finish pegging out the washing, I'd go and write. So one Saturday afternoon, I'm pegging out washing. I'm probably the only man in Victoria Point pegging out washing on a Saturday afternoon. And I can't say I heard an audible voice, I didn't. I just had this overwhelming thought in my head. Peter, you've got to ring Eva. No, Lord. Peter, you've got to ring Eva. It's urgent. I was so strong, I stopped doing what I was doing and I walked in under the house where the laundry was and I sat down in the tub chair and I said, Lord, I can't ring Eva. If you want me to ring Eva, you have to tell me what to say. The next thought came in, well, send her a text. Okay. What do I say in a text? So I sent Eva this text. Hi Eva, my name's Peter. Frank gave me your number. Is it okay if I ring him? And back to hanging washing. She sent me a text back and she said, oh, Peter, you really do exist. And she wasn't all that enthusiastic. She said something like, oh, do you really want to ring me? Okay. So I rang her. I can't remember. I don't have a clue what we said. I know it was only a short conversation, and it was basically a prelude to being able to ring her again. So in the meantime, between then and the next phone call, I had a sort of reality check, and I thought, ooh, what if she thinks I'm a wealthy solicitor? I don't want to give her the wrong impression, because I know everything's about to go down the drain. All right, that's what I'll tell her. So I rang her up the next time, it was a couple of days later. And I said, look, before we get any further, I just want to tell you my life's a mess. It's been a mess, but I said, I can imagine that I'll probably, you know, be bankrupt in the next few months. I'm sort of facing losing everything. I've got three boys that I love, and I've got a faith. Oh, she said, you've got a faith in God? I said, yeah, that's what's keeping me going. I said, I've got a faith. So have I, she said.
Oh, praise the Lord.
And that was our bond. That became our bond. She'd go to work, she did the shift she was on, she usually finished about, oh, I can't remember now, she got home about 10. 10 o'clock was about when I had to go to sleep. So we had this little window of opportunity at night when I'd finish reading and I'd be about to go to sleep and I'd ring her, she just got home, she'd say, can you hang on a minute, I've got to go to the bathroom, do whatever she had to do, get changed, feel fresh, and then we'd talk for 5 or 10 minutes and share. And if I said, what I used to share with her what I've been reading, you know, I read lots of stuff, I didn't just read the Bible, I'm just a voracious reader and writer. And I'd share her with something and she'd come back and she'd just quote a Bible text. It's like she knew the Bible. I'm thinking, wow, who knows the Bible like this? And she wasn't flaunting it, she was just comforting it. Anyway, eventually, Florence, Frank's wife, said to Eva, why don't you come down and meet Peter and see if there's any chemistry? So she didn't tell me that conversation. She just said, I'm coming down to visit Frank and Florence. And went to work that morning knowing she was coming out. I knew which flight she was on and I thought, oh, why should go to the airport and meet her? She wasn't expecting me. So I went out and I'm waiting there outside the gate she was going to come up. I'm thinking, well, this is dumb. How will I know? I didn't know what she looked like. She didn't know what I looked like. And I'm thinking, what if there's 10 Filipinos on this flight? So I thought, I'm just going to have to watch everyone get off the flight and work out which one she is. Anyway, so about the second or third person that got off was a really well presented lady. She had like a suit jacket on and a like folder or something, and I thought, she's a businesswoman, she looks nice. And I watched everyone get off, and there was a few Maori families and that, and I figured, oh gee, the only one I think might be here is that first one I saw. But it takes a while to watch everyone get off a flight, and then I'm thinking, oh my goodness, if it was that lady, she's gone. Like it's taken 10 minutes to watch everyone get off this flight, and she's probably met Frank and Florence and gone. Oh. So anyway, I go down to the baggage area, and that lady's there. Well, that's a miracle. Anyway, so I thought, well, I don't know if she's there or not. So I went up and I said, excuse me. She went around. Are you Eva? She goes, yes. I said, oh, I'm Peter. Ah! And what had happened, she was following the first guy off the flight, and he'd gone right out the wrong wing. So it had taken ages to get back, so that was good. So Frank and Florence were really sort of dumbfounded when we got out to the drive-thru and they saw me there. And yeah, so she had the long weekend down in Brizzy, and we went out like every 5 minutes. I found out what she liked that night, because I wanted to take her out somewhere really nice for dinner. I said, where would you like to go for dinner? She goes, oh, McDonald's. I said, no, you're
the right woman.
Seriously, where would you like to go for dinner? She goes, oh, well, if McDonald's is in that game, have they got Hungry Jack's here? So we went to McDonald's. We got married on the 3rd of January 2009, and I couldn't have had a better wife. It's like the Lord knew exactly who I needed. I mean, he did know who I needed. the prescription was just perfect. But I didn't, you know, as I said, I thought I was a Christian, but Eva trusted the Lord. Like, she didn't say she trusted the Lord, she just did.
Yeah.
And I didn't. You know, I trusted him for some things, but not everything. And I thought, I'm the breadwinner, I've got to worry about making the money. And I have to stress about it, you know. So when she came up here, I used to go for walks on Farnborough Beach and worry, you know, and stress. And I didn't trust the Lord in that time. I had to learn to trust the Lord. And I have, thanks to her example. If I didn't have Eva's example, this theory about trusting the Lord would probably still be a theory to me. But it no longer is. And I know the Lord walked through every step of our lives together before us. And he's gone before us and he's paved the way. And we just had to fit into it. And he's really taught me how much he loves both of us and how to trust him. And I've got her to thank for the part she's played in that, because it's not just about me and it's not just about her. We are one, and we are one in the Lord.
Yeah.
When she got ill, it was just such a shock. She never complained. She used to have a little bit of a tummy problem, and we thought it was irritable bowel syndrome as time went on, and she was trying all the pharmacy, basically the drugs she'd get by at the supermarket. And she didn't want to go to the doctor. She did want me to pray for her, which I did. And we tried to get her to go to the doctor, and she wouldn't. Even Cam made an appointment for her, which she wouldn't be. When we did end up going to Dr. Cabaget, and he took the blood test and did the scan, and he said, oh, you've got a mass in your colon. And I said, what does that mean? And he said, it's probably a malignant lesion. And then he went on, you're going to have to go and get a colonoscopy and I'll make the arrangements. And he didn't explain what a malignant lesion was. And I couldn't help myself, you know, Eva was watching telly that night and I went and Googled it. Worst thing I could have done. If you have a malignant lesion in your colon, according to Google, you've got about 6 months to live. So I nearly fell off my chair when I Googled that. And I went out and sat beside Eva in the lounge and I started to cry and trying to hide it from her because I didn't want to tell her. But I had to live with that until it was actually confirmed what she had, so I didn't want to tell her. But I think she knew. And she didn't complain. And there's a couple of the photos where she's in a purpley dress. They were taken on the Saturday, 5th of October. And Steve and Linda were up, and they brought Laura from where she lives, just south of Basin. And the photos show Eva out on our front porch, smiling, just being Eva. And that was, when they went home, that night was the night she locked up, had to get the ambulance to come at 5 o'clock next morning, took her up to Rocky, and they admitted her straight away. She locked up, they said, we have to get the flying doctor to take her to Rocky, to Brisbane, sorry. Probably go this afternoon. Can you go home and pack some things, man? So I did. She didn't actually go till the next morning, so I flew down the Monday night, and my middle son Cameron and Paula, they picked me up from the airport, took me to see Eva. She was in tremendous pain, even the drug she was on. So she didn't really want visitors, and she sort of said, oh, you know, you guys go home, get comfy. So I went home to their house at Wynnum, and the next morning I had to get back to the hospital, and I had to get public transport. Now, I'd lived in Brisbane for a long time, but I'd never used public transport for a long time. And Paula said, oh, here's my go card. No, what's a go card? So I had to get the train from Wynnum to the valley, then get a bus from the valley up to the hospital, and I had to go to the service station to top up the go card before I got on the train. So I did all this, and I get on the train, and it's a commuter train, it's full of people, and I said to a fellow, excuse me, sir, where do I tap the card? And he looked at me and he didn't answer me, so I sat down to another guy, I said, excuse me, mate, where do I tap the go card? And he goes, oh, haven't you tapped on? I said, no, because the only time I'd ever done this sort of thing was in Melbourne on a tram, and you do it on the tram. And he said, oh, mate, if they catch you, it's a big fine. I said, well, where do you do it? He goes, you've got to do it on the platform before you get on. You better get off at the next station. So, okay, I'm thinking, well, everyone's going to, there's a big dummy jumping off the train. Got to find out where to tap, jump back on the train. Then I get to the valley, and you have to find out how to get a bus to the hospital. Eventually, I get up to the hospital, and I walk into the ward, and Eva goes, where have you been? You're not here on holidays, you know. It's the only time I got grumpy with that. Anyway, she had to wait 2 weeks for the operation because she was all blocked up and they were trying to free it up a bit. She had the operation on a Friday, came back into the ward Friday evening, and they said, oh, everything went well. And, you know, she's still groggy, so about 7:30 I've got public transport back to Wynnum. About midnight, a fella rings me up. He said, Mr. Clapton, I'm so-and-so, I can't remember his name, from the hospital, I'm a surgeon. He said, we're just taking Eva back into theatre. It's just a little problem. Don't come up. We'll ring you back in 2 hours. So I'm sitting there at Wynnum. About 3 a.m, they rang me and he said, oh, look, where we had the operation, they had a little stone of that, just a little one like that. He said, oh, it was pinching a little bit. We freed it up. We think we fixed the problem. But when you come up in the morning, she won't be back in the ward. She'll be in the ICU. Mm-hmm. Okay, so as soon as I could, I get up to the ICU. And Eva's there. And anyone who's been in an ICU, you know it's not a pretty sight. People are hooked up to machines and things. And I said hello to her. And I'd only just been there in, like, I don't know, 2 or 3 minutes. And a guy walks over to me, who was a doctor, and he said, can I see you for a minute? And I said, yeah. And he said, are you the husband? And I said, yes. He said, look, your wife's not doing very well. Just made a decision. We're going to put her to sleep. Might help her cope with pain. I said, what do you mean put her to sleep? He said, oh, just for a couple of days. Might just help her get over the pain. He said, so look, just go and say goodbye to now, and because we're going to do this now. Oh, okay. So I walked back out of the bed and I said, darling, they're just going to give you a drug and put you to sleep. And before I finished, the nurse came out and said, oh, look, love, we're just going to give you something and we're just going to put you to sleep. And Eva looked at her and she said, what, like in a coma? And she goes, yeah, a bit like that. And anyway, so she was supposed to wake up on the Monday. So they pushed me out. They don't need to stay in the ICU long for anything. So they said, you just go wait outside. So I waited outside for a few hours. And then a lady surgeon comes back to me and she said, look, we're just taking Eva back to theatre again. There's a problem. Oh no, sorry, it wasn't her. It was another guy. He came out, that's right. He sat down beside me and he spoke a million miles an hour. Oh, blah, 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 blah. We're doing this and we're doing that. And I didn't get any of what he said to me, except there was a problem. So then I waited a couple more hours and then the lady surgeon came, that's right. And she was a lot more cohesive and she explained to me, look, there'd been something had leaked and there was this turbid fluid in her tummy cavity. And she said, look, we've mopped it up, we've done the best we can, and we'll keep an eye on it. And she's still in this induced coma, so there's nothing you can do. You know, it's about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You might as well go home and, you know, come back tomorrow. So I rang Cameron and I said, look, Cam, I'm coming back. Can we go down the coast and see my other two sons who they're running a restaurant down at Coolangatta? And Cam said, yeah, that's good, Dad, we'll do that. So we went down there and we had a lovely evening. And about 9:30, 10, I get a phone call from another doctor. And he said, oh, your wife's not doing very, very well. We're losing her. We want you to come back and spend the night with her and say goodbye. I was completely shocked and my mobile phone battery died. So I said to Cam, come on, you better take me home. You better take me to the hospital. And on the way, I better stop and get my mobile phone charger. And then on my way, I thought, well, I better have a shower and freshen up. So I thought, I'm going to the hospital to say goodbye to my darling wife for the last time. And I just didn't know how to deal with this. I was just, well, the only way I could deal with it was in prayer. So I prayed my heart out between then and the hospital. And as it turned out, we took a long time to get there. Firstly, we left Cam's flat. We got along Wynnum Road and we came across an accident. We were the first ones on the scene and a lady got killed in an accident. She's spread eagled in front of the car. I still don't know how to make any sense of that. A million other people arrived just afterwards, so we didn't have to stay at the scene. And we, emergency services people were sort of taking statements from us over the phone and car. Then when we got to go through the valley, it was the Mardi Gras or something, and we couldn't get through the valley. All the roads were closed, so it took us another half an hour so to get through there. By the time we got to the hospital, it was midnight. They let me off, I went up, buzzed to say I was there, and they just told me to wait in the waiting room. And I waited for like 2 hours. It was after 2 in the morning when they let me in. And the doctor came and he said, Mr. Clapham, weren't you here today? And I said, yes. He said, why have you come back? And I said, well, a doctor rang me and told me to come back and say goodbye to my wife. Oh, he said, yes, we did have a lot of problems tonight. We couldn't get the dialysis machine to work, etc. But he said, look, don't get me wrong, she's still very, very ill, but she's responded. And so we're doing our best, and she's not in as grave a condition as she was. So what a blessing. And that's when the church kicked in, friends kicked in, the family kicked in the Philippines. Everyone started praying for Eva. She didn't come out of the coma on the Monday like she was supposed to, and I had doctors sort of prepping me for the worst and saying she could have brain damage for being, you know, out of it for so long. And expecting the worst, telling me that it's not right to keep people on life support systems in certain situations and whatever, but our faith didn't waver. And I'm walking through the ICU one day, and the doctor was walking the other way, and I didn't know, and she stopped and she said, excuse me, are you Eva's husband? And I said, yes. And she said, oh, I met your wife before she was in the coma. She said, she's such a stoic person.
Mm.
So I Googled stoic, because I think of stoics being philosophers. And I Googled stoic, and basically stoic means, in that context, a person who accepts what happens without without complaining or showing emotion. Mm. I thought, yeah, she said it right, because Eva demonstrated her that she's a stoic person from then on. She came out of the coma on a Thursday. I was just about to come back to Brisbane, fly back to Brisbane that night. And I'd been taking people's advice. I'd been sitting beside a bed talking to her. You know, it wasn't easy to talk to someone when you don't know if they're listening or not, but I was trying hard, and you've got the nurses listening to you. I'm shy, but anyway, I did my best. And when she came out of the coma, I was trying to, she wanted to tell me something, but she had this big tube stuck down her throat, and she had a tube in her nose, and she couldn't talk. And she was really frustrated. She's dying to tell me something. And I don't think she's going to tell me, oh, darling, I love you, or, you know, thanks for being by my side. Mm. I don't know what she's going to tell me. So I went and got some paper and a pen, and I'm trying to help her write. And first of all, it wasn't making any sense. And finally, I got to read what she wrote, and it wrote, Coke with a straw. There's sadness in a parting, but I remember that, you know, throughout all this time we had with her being ill, Eva didn't show any fear. She had some tears at times, but it was sadness for us. Just like when she didn't want to tell the family because she didn't want them to grieve for her while they're still grieving for Pat. That's what she's about. She had no fear. And she left it up to the Lord. He'll either heal me or he won't. But she was worried about us being left behind to grieve. The four scripture readings that the ladies did, thank you for that. I hope they just told the story that I wanted to tell from here on in, where she is. And the gospel messages that Phil and Paul gave, they just speak to me that death reminds us of what a serious business life is. Back on the gratitude, because I believe what I've spoken. I want to publicly thank some people. Most of them aren't here, but I just feel I owe it to them to say thank you formally. And I'll sort of go in chronological order. So, Dr. Kavajit Gujral, who is a GP at Emu Park Family Practice, he couldn't have been more spot on with his diagnosis, and he tried to do what he could. He was about to go on holidays when all that happened, so he couldn't do any more. Claire Braithwaite, who is a nurse, but also was practicing as a solicitor when Eva fell ill. And she was such a steady help to me because she also has had her own problems with bowel problems. And she's obviously a very good nurse. Her father's a doctor. And she was able to tell me what to expect next along the way, even in the time before I had told Eva that what a malignant lesion was. Yes, I'm very grateful to Claire for the help she gave. And she was available to me, like, at night whenever I needed to give her a call. Flying doctor service. The surgical team at the RBWH, there were about four doctors in that team that Eva was under her care for the whole 3.5 months, under their care, the 3.5 months that she spent at the Royal Brisbane. And they got to love Eva, I could tell that, and they went out of their way to try and find ways, to try and make things better. I mean, after she had 9 operations in less than a week and a half, and they couldn't sew her tummy back up. Eva had only had one operation in her life before, and that was when she was trying to fall pregnant, and she still resented the fact that she had a mark on her tummy from that, and it was a waste of time. And so to go from that to have a tummy they couldn't sew up and have to cope with that, and she did. You know, she had a backpack there for 3 months. They couldn't sew her up at the end. They did a skin graft over the wound, and they did a beautiful job. And then when it was... she wanted to come home, they backed her. I mean, there was a lot of people didn't think she'd be able to come home, but they backed her and they wanted me to learn the TPN. And even when the TPN specialist said, no way that she can go home on TV. And they insisted, you know, we fought for it, and then Dr. Hodges changed her mind. And we were crying about it, so, yep. The doctors and nurses at the ICU they're the most dedicated people I've ever met. I mean, those nurses do a 12-hour shift one-on-one with a patient on their feet, looking at the machines, monitoring everything. They live in a different world, and they're amazing. The nurses in Ward 9A North, they were all lovely, but to know them all on a first-name basis, and they were all fantastic. And Dr. Hodges, the gastroenterologist, who I kind of had a lot of angst for first when I found out she wasn't going to let us go home on TPN, but I came to have a lot of respect for afterwards when she did, and we've had sort of constant meetings with her and her team since then to monitor our progress along the road at the TPN, and I've got to love Dr. Hodges since. Kay Lazenby, who is the clinical nurse from that gastroenterology department, and Emma, the dietitian. Those two have been on call for me, anything I needed. The TPN process was a bit daunting, but they've rung me sort of sometimes every week just to see how I get on, or how we were, how Eva was, and yeah, I regard them as really good friends now, and I think they think likewise. Dr. Debbie Ibbotson, when we came home from the RBH, it wasn't practical to go to a doctor in Yipoon, so we changed doctors and started going to Dr. Debbie Ibbotson now. I asked Claire to recommend a doctor, and she's the one Claire recommended, but Claire said, you probably won't get Dr. Debbie because she stopped seeing any new patients for a year ago. But when Dr. Debbie saw Eva's condition, she but Dr. Denny is probably the best GP we could have ever had. She came around and did a friendship visit Friday night and the week before he passed, so very grateful. The oncology and radiation doctors and nurses, I've appointed Cody with care team and Rocky, Dr. Cody, Dr. Dean, Jose, who's the registrar, and the two nurses, Rosalind and Linda. The Auscare nurses, Raven and Jen Ann, that looked after Eva, helped Nance look after Eva in the last 2 months. They were fantastic. Raven even came, was her holidays. She even came the day he passed away to be there, help wash her and sign the death certificate thing. And Queensland Cancer Council, they were the bus to meet us at the airport. They gave us the accommodation when we were down there for the radiation in May. Couldn't have done it without all those services. And you know, they were all free, you know, like provided by the government. Just so grateful. Friends and family, those who prayed for Eva when it seemed that the doctors at the ICU had basically given up hope. Can't thank you enough. You know, I remember I'd be at the railway station waiting for the train, people would be texting, we're praying for Eva. Mm-hmm. Even Ron at the back said to me on Skype, I don't pray much for Eva, but I'm praying for Eva. Thank you, Ron. People who drove long distances to visit, there's lots of them. People who just called in once, thank you. You all got a smile on Eva's face. Linda and Steve, you've already mentioned, but I've got to thank you too. Who drive all the way from Benarabi nearly every weekend.
That's right.
To be with us. I mean, I don't know who else would do that. Always thought, before we met Nancy, always thought Linda was probably closer to Eva than a sister could be. And Linda, you are a sister. You all brought wonderful smiles to Eva's face. My work, Cam, thanks for having the courage and the confidence in me to allow me to spend work from Eva's bedside all those times. We got through, thank you. Lani, thanks for being a wonderful backup. Couldn't have done it without you. I look back and I don't know when that week that we were in Brisbane for the radiation, we had like 6 settlements or something, but I don't know how we did it, but we did, praise the Lord. Our church family, unwavering, unsolicited spiritual, emotional and financial support and assistance. That's what I've written here, and it's true. You guys are the epitome of the love that the Lord had in mind when he told his disciples to take care of each other. The ladies that did the readings, they've been coming down to our place every Wednesday, I don't know, for months. Firstly, just to minister and look after Eva. But then, as Eva got worse, to look after Nance as well. And they're still looking after Nance. Thank you so much. Nancy, thank you so much for putting your life on hold. We just couldn't have done it without you. I couldn't have gone to work, earned the money I needed to earn to keep the house without you and looked after Nuts. You know, there's no way I would have stopped looking after Nuts, but you gave me the ability to do both. And I'm just so grateful that even getting her here as quickly as she did, that's a miracle. Nancy had no passport when we started the process, no visa. And then Joe and Annabelle, they helped with the paperwork, but Annabelle was at our place on a Saturday afternoon, spent the Saturday afternoon beside Eva's bedside, and she said, look, Peter, she was about to go to the Philippines for 2 weeks. She said, if you can get Nancy's visa through, I'll bring her back with me. And I thought, well, that's really lovely. I've never thought about that. That's a wonderful sentiment, but that's impossible. I can't get the visa in 2 weeks. Well, I didn't get it. Someone else did. She got the visa in 2 weeks, and Annabelle and Joe brought her back with her. And that's just another amazing testimony to the way the Lord's looked after us. So if there's anyone going back, you know, like towards the end of January or in March, that would be happy to shepherd Nancy home, I'd be forever grateful. And lastly but not least, I'd just like to thank the Lord, because throughout this process, he's been looking after me. You know, he got me a job. That's another story, when I needed it. You know, went through all those financial problems, Eva stuck with me. She never complained once. She just stuck to her guns. You know, she believed that, she told me that whatever you want to do, Peter, you can do. I didn't even have that faith myself. I don't have any confidence in myself. But she said, yeah, the Lord's with you. You can do it. I had the best mentor possible. And I just, you know, whether you share my faith or not, I just hope that, you know, you all can have a relationship with God that's real and living like I do, because there's no other reason we're here, except to equip us for that next life. Just a little plug. I am going to finish a book, and it's a book called Sonship. I started to write it for my sons, then I started to write it for a whole lot of other people I had in mind. And I haven't finished it yet, but now I'll make this declaration out. For Eva, and for anyone who's keen to read it, I'm going to finish it.
Very good. So I've got a quick song, but those that are getting ready for the open floor, if you can, once I'm finalised with the song, 2-3 minutes, if you're coming up, if you can come and stand over here. Like I said, if we can keep it to 2 minutes, 3 minutes, something short, just like that, we'll probably leave it open for maybe... Well, if there's nobody, that's fine, but if there's other people that have things to say, maybe go for 20 minutes, something on those lines, okay? So so just to give you a time frame. Sometimes there's songs that find you, and I have sung this at different times, and I'm not a singer. I wish I was. But if anything, this is my gift to the family. Story would end. guess I'll have to try. It's not easy to say goodbye. For all the joy we've shared, all that time we had to spend, say something, and now's your time to do it. If we can keep it briefly, that'd be great. But yeah, remember to use the mic if you can. Good on you, Dale.
I think it will take me a few minutes because I have to read something from Linda and another friend from Weston. Hi, good morning to everyone. I'm Sylvia Wright. Thank you for coming to share with everyone as we celebrate the life of our dear friend,
Eva. My husband and I have known Eva since the mid-80s. She was the first Filipina I met in Caloy Bay. Eva was a reserved person, but once you know her, she's friendly, understanding, kind, and honest. She used to organize friends for a get-together, having a barbie in her place. This start our friendships amongst us new arrivals in Gladstone and Caloy Bay area. Because of her friendship, she became one of the godmothers of my daughter. A sad part in her life came when her marriage ended, but you know, she handled it well. She was devastated, but she did her best to be independent. She learned to drive, did a course in type, and find work. She spent more time with her family, especially Nancy's in the Philippines. She worked here in Rocky. She loved her work and well liked by everyone. Meeting Peter was the biggest joy in her life. Married to him made her more happy and fulfilled. Eve, we're gonna miss you, but the happy memories of you will always stay with us forever. Mm. Now this is from Linda, the lady that helped her almost every weekend. The memorable talks of our friend Linda about Eva. In the 26 years that I have known Eva, I grow to appreciate her honesty and kindness. She went through ups and downs in life as everyone does. I'll never forget the happiness she had when she first told us about meeting Peter. They are couples that seem like a perfect match. Peter and Eva were one of those. I was so happy to see her finally having happiness and contentment in life. My family shared many good times together. One is when we were fishing. I'm sure you have seen
The kissing fish.
Yeah, fishing in there. Eva overexcitedly reefed in a fish on her rod so hard that the fish flew out of the water just missing Peter's head. Just imagine that. Before bouncing back into the boat. That day, she caught the two biggest fish of the day. I'll never forget Eva's strength and courage throughout the toughest battle of her life. No matter how sick or in pain, she would always put a smile for everyone and say, I'm okay. And that's from Linda. And this is from Anya, another friend from Gladstone. Eva, a friend and knowing her is a blessing. A gentle and soft-spoken person. Have good laughs and some tears, but always cherish her sweet smile and the memories of good times. From all of us, Gladstone area, Caloy Bay and Manara Bay, Eve, you're always in our hearts. Mm. We all love you, Bakit. Thank you.
Actually got a message from the family as well, if you click on that.
I don't really know what to say, as until now I still can't believe. Auntie Nati, thank you for everything. Having you as one of our aunties is such a great thing. You made us experience going through tourist spots here in our city. We have a lot of memories that I will never forget. Auntie Nati, thank you very, very, very much for everything. I will never forget your sweet smile, your calming voice, your expressive eyes. One of our memories I can still remember is when you teach me how to eat apple with vinegar, and until now that was my favorite. Thank you very much for everything. You will not be here physically, but please always do remember that your memories is in always in our hearts. Thank you very much for everything. And to Uncle Peter, thank you very much also for taking good care of my auntie. Our family is very grateful to you because your love is very unlimited for her. And to the two friends that helped Auntie Nati through his journey, maraming maraming salamat po. And I know you're listening, Auntie. You're resting now. You will rest now. Wala ka ng problema dyan. Everything will be okay soon. And I know, soonest. Thank you very much. And we will miss you. I love you.
Many years ago, when I had a shop in Hamar, I met someone from Gladstone. And she said, where did you come from, the Philippines? And I said, Mountain Province. They call us mountaineers. So she said, do you know someone from Mountain Province in Gladstone? I said, no. So she gave me the name Eva and her phone number. So one day I said, I might bring her. She's from our same place. We have the same culture. So I was speaking to her and I asked her. She told me everything. And I asked her, would you like to come and stay in our canton? So one day she did come, and that was the beginning of our friendship. I found her to be very honest, very soft-spoken. She has this love of her family and friends, and she missed everything at home. But I told her that we are all here and we will have our life, make our life better here. So she came to Rocky, and she lives very simply, and yet she had a big heart for friends that she knew and her family. She's very, very easy to get along with. And you cannot fault her. She is very, and I know Peter would know because she lives with her, but she's very flexible. She's not argumentative. When I was in the Philippines, I heard that she had gotten sick, and as a nurse, I would imagine that she'd be very lonely, because hospital is actually a very lonely place. So I ran her and I've spoken to her, and she had, I know the enormity of the illness, but she was still laughing, smiling, and as if she's still very lively, and the way she talked, it's just like she accepted everything. So this is newsletter. That was before she got hospitalized. Newsletter, she met her soulmate Peter, and she was so ecstatic and in love. She loves him with all her heart and soul. So they came around to our place, to Peter, and I was very happy that she had found press on me because she deserves it. She told me everything, how good Peter is, and it's proven. We saw Peter sacrifice all her day, all his days, looking after Eva. And I always said to some continuous, we are very, very glad that she met Peter. I couldn't explain how good he is, because working in a hospital for more than 40 years, I had met people who got ill. And the way I looked up here, everything was really there. I went to the hospital to visit her, and Peter has just finished work. And he came all along out from Gladstone to give hygiene to her. And then he has to go back and prepare food for himself. And that is a very job for a man who goes to work, come back and look after the household. That is, we're very, very lucky that we have you, Peter, and we have to look after our own people. This is a little poem for her. God saw you getting tired when a cure was not to be. So he wrapped his arms around you and whispered, "Come to me." You didn't deserve what you went through, so he gave you a rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He only takes rest. And when I saw you sleeping, so peaceful and free from pain, I could not wish you back to suffer that again.
Amen.
I left out the most important part of my talk. I'm sorry. I know I spoke for you. But the urgency when I was taken out to washing turned out to be that Eva was about to pack up, leave Australia. She was going to go and spend a few weeks with a friend in South Australia and then go to the Philippines for good. So if I hadn't run her the day I did, I would never have met her.
So if you're married here today, look at the person next to you. That's God's best for you. God puts them together. Man tears them apart. Okay, we're going to sing a final song, Amazing Grace. And that's a song that Pete's requested, so we'll do that one. Now, after this, we're going to have what we've termed the laying of the frangipani, and that will be the closing of the service. So we'll close in prayer. After this song, and then what we'll do is we're going to have the Filipino ladies that we're going to hold the frangipanis. If you can come and stand up the side here. As we go past, we just want everyone to take a frangipani and just lay it beside Eva's ashes over there. So by the end of it, it should be a sea of frangipanis. Our little island flower has wilted and gone, so let's put some fresh ones on there. Eh? Here we go.
Grace.
chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secure. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God, you call me here below, will be forever mine. The chains are gone. Her chains are gone, she's been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. Okay, so before we do the frangipani thing, and we've got our lovely assistants over here, ready to go. So you pick one out of the basket and go from there. We're just going to close in a quick word of prayer. And like I say, after this is over, we'd love for you to stay and enjoy some of the food that's there. Plenty for one and for all. Once again, if you want a drink at the end of this, there's drinks at the bar over here. The water's free. If you want anything else, bring out the card. You know what I mean? What's that? Tea and coffee is over there for free, though, in the corner. So if you're a teetotaler, go for there. Okay, so a couple of thoughts. I can't find the stinker thing. Here we go. It's hiding. Genesis 3. Here we go. Let's start with that. It says in Genesis 3, it says, unfortunately, the only thing different between Eva and us is time. And so what Genesis 3 says is that we are formed from the dust, and to the dust we return. And if that was the end of the story, that would be tragic. But the book of John gives you an insight, because it says this, that at the last day, I will raise them from the dust of the earth. And Eva today is standing with the Lord. Her soul is with Jesus, but she longs for the day to be clothed with her new body. Not a body full of cancer, not a body full of pain and suffering and sickness, but she will be clothed with incorruption, with immortality. And she will be the Eva that we all know, with all the memories that we all know, knowing you and knowing me, to quote an ABBA song. But she shall be raised at the last day from the dust of the earth, and we all long for that day appearing. At the moment, she has left the room, and we are sad for her departure. but we look for the day where we are reunited in the upper room. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your presence amongst us, God, and we thank you for the life of Eva Natividad. Lord, we just bless you for her. God, the memories, the laughter, the tears, everything that comprises a life, Lord, we thank you for every part of it. Lord, the dark strokes are as important as the bright white ones. And so, God, we just thank you for all of her life. We bless you for allowing us to share it with her. God, we pray a blessing upon the food at the back as we partake of that. But God, we pray, Lord, that as people come by with their frangipani, Lord, they can say their goodbyes and whatever needs to be said at that time. Lord, I pray that everyone will just depart from this place safely, have a safe Christmas, enjoy family, because people's where it's at. Enjoy those that you have around you. They are a blessing from God. And we thank you for this time together in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Finally, we get to stand. Everyone can stand.
It's over now. It's over, I'm gone. It's over now. It can't be long. The prisons of my past couldn't hold me, I'm free. My father, I see his arms reaching for me. It's over now. When I look back to yesterday and upon the many years I've wasted, and I think about the many nights of hunger that I spent out in the cold, I remember warming by the fire at Father's house the food, how it tasted. And knowing that the life I'm leading is needing love, and love's back there at home. It's over now.
It's over now.
It's over. It's over now.
It's over now.
It can't be long. Prisons of my past couldn't hold me. I'm free at last. My father, I see his arms reaching for me. It's over. Ring of gold, and with it bring the finest robe I've stayed for.